tracks in a mechanized or tanker. Okay? These guys move forward and they stop at a covered position. And this is good, because two means that they can be looking this way, and that way, and that way. And then when they're in position, these guys move up to here. They do the same thing. You know how that works when you only have three? Doesn't work real well, no, it doesn't. Because you're either sending, you've got either an adequate overwatch, the people who are in back, they're also looking out, ready to fire. Or you've got the adequate overwatch, you've only got one track going forward on its own, and he's really nervous. He's really, really nervous. What, just me? No, no, no. If there were two of us, at least I have a 50% chance that she can. Just me? No, no, no. You do it the other way, you know, you have, like, I'm not even going to try to describe it, where you've got one guy in overwatch and two moving forward, the overwatch is inadequate, and it takes forever to do because somebody's zigzagging all the time. That's what I go to. The other one. Okay, function. Very good. You know, most things in battle, anybody who's been in battle? Okay. Yeah, you. Jeremy has the world record, he's the world champion on finding IEDs the hard way.
I hate you all.
How many did you find, Jeremy?
3 in 4 months.
Very good. And he's alive, that doesn't happen, you know. Although I think Justin has, he may be a close contender. I think he probably
God
too.
Bless Oshkosh Defense Corporation.
Yeah, really.
Be a wonderful truck.
Oh, it's a great truck. Yeah, I was going to buy it.
Only one we counted.
Only one we counted, okay.
No.
Battle is very, very slow. You think it's quick from the movies, but it's not. A real, real combat, you know, it's slow. Okay? You have time to issue orders most of the time. You have time, sometimes you have a lot of time to issue orders. So why do you want to drill it if for something that's probably not going to be appropriate most of the time, if you'll have time to issue an order that is appropriate? Is it a matter of immediate life and death? You know? Some things that we do, we can kill ourselves with. Demolitions is a pretty good example. Right? Yeah, you want to drill demo so it's done perfectly every time. If you're doing Bangalore, you want to drill it so it's done perfectly and quickly, because the enemy's trying to kill you while you're trying to blow your way through the wire. Anybody does know what Bangalore is? Okay, good. Somebody who's honest. A Bangalore is a series of pipes filled with explosives. You link them together and slide them under obstacles or through minefields, works that way too. With a cap in the back, when you get it through, they're about to, I want to say, 45 feet long. Is that right?
That's put them all together.
Yeah, the whole box.
It used to be nine
in the dummy. I'm not sure what it was now. Anyway, the enemy's trying to kill you because he doesn't want you to get through his wire. So you want to practice that and get it quick. So you can get away from it and blow the hole through the wire and continue your attack. By the way, you know where the army's real Bangalore drill came from? It's not commonly known. The movie Big Red One. We had no clue how to use Bangalore.
Yeah.
So we went back to a movie that I think used
That's why I was just asking him which one was it where everybody in the platoon had a number.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The lower your number, the more likely you were going to get killed, because number one has to go out and push. Once number one gets shot, number two has to go out and push.
Right. Well, that part, that was kind of bullshit, but the way of doing it, that really, we picked it up from the movie, but I think they got it from someone who was in World War II. But that's immediate life and death. A near ambush is immediate life and death. Okay. Get the hell out of the kill zone and assault. It's your only chance. Most things are not immediate life and death. Is it simple? Only simple stuff works. You know, I've seen some amazing complex battle drills that are just so stupid.
Bang.
Bang.
Your immediate action drills for a failure to fire.
We used to call.
Well, that's not a battle drill. It's an individual drill, but yeah.
Yeah.
Can your enemy easily adapt? That's part of predictability, which I think you already mentioned. But if your enemy can adapt to it easily, maybe you don't want to make it a drill. You know, maybe that's not the right thing. and does it teach the wrong lessons? One wrong lesson is that drills are a panacea for all your military problems. Yeah?
It almost sounds like you're saying drills firmly survive contact with the enemy.
Well, no, they don't. All right, but initially they might. After the enemy has a little time to get used to them, then no, they don't. What I'm saying is, for the most part, it's not something, they're not things to train on. And I'll show you my personal list of what I allowed my company to do. React to an air ambush, life or death, immediately, okay? And it's simple, too. React to anti-HGM, same anti-tank guided missile, same thing, okay? Feed, fuel, and arm is not life or death. Did anyone guess what it was, you can kind of picture this. Picture a fuel truck, a truck full of ammo, a mess truck, and a trash truck in a line. Armored personnel carriers come up on either side, and the first guy goes to it's a garbage truck, and he tosses a bag of garbage over to the truck, which tosses the back of the garbage bag. Next one's a mess, and he holds up. That's how many guys are in the track. They dish out 7 meals on the paper plates, cover them, and pass them all over. This is everybody is rolling, including the trucks. Okay? And they pass them all over. All right, the next one is fuel, and they're still rolling, and the fuel guys, 76 whiskeys at the store back then, pass over the hose, and they're filling the track while they're still rolling. Right? Then they get to the ammunition, and they've sent someone out while they're refueling to run like hell with a list of ammunition. Guys in the ammo truck start sorting it out, they start tossing it over and cracking it up. And it's a whole continuous thing. It took 11 minutes to feed, fuel, and arm my company. And collect garbage. It's really pretty cool. Okay, well, why did I do it? I just told you why, if you got it. Saved a hell of a lot of training time. That's why I did it. But it was also useful in war. And it was kind of fun. Soviet MRC, Motorized Rifle Company, and Online Assault. Yes, our company has only 5 battle drills that they're willing to do, and one of them is Russia. Okay, this is a true story. Another true story. We were doing battalion RTEPs, which is a long story of why that makes no sense whatsoever, but that's what we were doing anyway. A platoon RTEPs at the battalion, that's what it was. And we're taking myself and another company, it was a good company, okay? We're taking turns being each other's enemies to this. Well, I don't know what the hell they did to crap, but I took my company and we did the Soviet motorized rifle company, because the Russians were still the enemy back then. And that was the assault from a column march. And it worked like this. Companies column rolling, okay? At about 1,200 meters, they formed 3 platoon columns. 3 tracks, complementary back. 3 tracks, complementary back. At about 800 meters, they form on line. And this supposed to be tank, we have it. At about 400 meters, the troops start jumping out of the back of the moving track, and they run around in front. At about 75 meters, the platoon leaders call into the assault forward, and the troops go, "Hoorah!" and charge. Oh, we added one other thing to it, which was fixed bayonets. Okay, we go against the first platoon of this other company. They weren't expecting this, they dropped their shit. We go to the second platoon of that company. They weren't expecting this. They dropped their shit and ran. And I was waiting. I let my lieutenants take their turn, being playing company commander as a matter of officer professional development. And I was watching from the friendly side, the people who were being attacked. And the third platoon was getting ready for them. The battalion commander.
Oh,
good.
I'm on drugs.
Okay. Well, save some. Battalion commander declared, because he was getting embarrassed, actually, battalion commander was. He declared an unplanned for, uncalled for, basket, family of scoundrel mines, minefield, in front of the company, declared the assault at the end. But I was there watching, they were getting ready to drop the shit on too. Okay. And after we did that, that's why we kept Soviet motorized rifle company assault, because it kind of worked. We could use it for Op 4, you know, playing commie, and we could even use it fighting Arabs, maybe, which is sort of our focus. And then fire the whole motherfuckers, Bangalore's the devil, which I already discussed. It's life or death, and it's got to be done quickly. That's all. I didn't permit any of it.
Yep, shoot. only tune level RTEP I thought was worthwhile, because if you screw that up, you're going to drop your rounds in the wrong place.
Well, actually,
the artillery that's back in, you know, versus back in.
No, he's talking mortars, actually.
Yeah,
mortars, company level mortars.
Yeah. Actually, the mortar RTEPs weren't that bad. They were a lot more objectively measurable than almost anything that the regular line dogs did. Okay. So, working on intellectual faculties. Moral faculties that require thought. And education, and it's mostly but not entirely to read. Okay. How do you do it? Well, you read. I was an awful brain. In addition to keeping the troops out in the field about 20 to 22 days and nights a month, I gave my lieutenants book reports to do. And it was a little bit like I did with my sergeants. Initially, I told them what books, and then after a few months, I let them figure out what books they wanted. They had to get me a copy to read in advance, and I approved it or not, depending on whether I thought it was books. They reported them. And so I keep my parental life. I had a beautiful life, but I still had a adult life that was really better than my life. Okay, counseling statements. In general, you develop people through that. I can talk about counseling a lot. Maybe someday I will. I'm not going to now. Okay, who knows what a tune is? Huh? Tactical exercise without troops. Okay, that's where you just take the leaders out to the field. You know, maybe just the two leaders and their drivers and tracks and a company commander to represent the entire company. You know what a tune is? Anybody? Jungle exercise without trees. And how about a penis? Penis is practical exercise not involving soldiers. War gaming. It's, like Avalon Hill type games, SDI type games, computer games. It can be useful. The best use I've found for that, actually, was the company commanders in the battalion used to get together to play on a regular basis. And you learn a lot about people that way. To the point that, I remember one example in particular. We were stuck at a ford. This was a major division exercise. And another company behind, I was the lead company, and I dismounted everybody, we went across, we cleared the other side, okay? And then, for various reasons, the dead bodies get back in the tracks, but the tracks are still good. And I ordered Thunder Run, Black Six, Thunder Run, Thunder Run, Thunder Run, Order of March, and gave red, white, blue, gold, green, and diamond. After the air defense guys, I have the answer. Right? And this other company commander knew what I was doing because we war game together on a regular basis. So that's one of the more useful aspects of it. And you develop people by example. By developing the ethics in the unit, I thought I'd break that in. And you do it all the time, every day, every way, but you need to think about it. Okay, those are, for example, the some things you want to develop. Those are the 14 leadership traits: bearing, courage, decisiveness, dependability, endurance, enthusiasm, initiative, integrity, judgment, justice, knowledge, loyalty, tact, and unselfishness, which is not bad for an old man getting senile, And basically, some of them you condition, most of them you develop, and some of them are needed. Anybody, you can argue this, by the way, that's just my take on it. Our logistic ethos is maximum feasible usage. The tanks, vehicle fuel tanks always have to be topped off. The ammunition always has to be topped off. Well, unfortunately, war doesn't work like that. And sometimes you run short. It's always easy to deal with plenty. That takes no skill whatsoever. It takes no discipline whatsoever. Dealing with constraints is much harder. So one way you might develop a unit is by, say, draining the tanks, the fuel tanks of all your vehicles before you go to the field. And then you give everybody 5 gallon can diesel. And you do all of your resupply at a reduced level. 5 gallon cans and the back of Jeep trailers. Well, not Jeeps anymore, it's all Hummers. Tell them what's better. Teaching the troops to keep their tanks topped off, or teaching them to do that anytime. They'll do that naturally if they think there's use for it. Or teaching them to be frugal. and to plan. Okay, I have to get this far. I need this much diesel to do it. It's hard to explain, actually.
You can run into a situation where you teach people to be, like you're talking about, you know, where they're gaming the system. You run into a situation where you're teaching people to be too frugal because now they're worried about tomorrow, and so they get killed today because they're not.
Remember, we're training them
right.
to be frugal when necessary.
Right.
When war comes around, you push as much as they can take.
Yeah.
But you've trained them in advance to be frugal when they need to be.
The reason that works, I did that, was that you don't always have Italian trains that you can run your guys through. Sometimes you're actually on your first sergeant. We're driving jeeps and trailers with shit on the back of them, and you couldn't bring the whole deuce and a half full of stuff. It just wasn't feasible.
I was a sports leader in Panama one time. I'll get the gist. And it was like 500 miles of trackless jungle, and we were cut off. So I ended up supplying the battalion with one deuce and a half that was stuck with me at the trains. I took over the signal platoon, and they were carrying shit in backpacks to people that were out there. And we were slipping stuff across the canal on rubber boats and LCNs. It was more fun than you would imagine doing that shit. Really having a challenge to work with. Justin?
Oh, no, I was about to say, very much like what you're talking about, at one point in NTC, my artillery battery's 5 kilometers behind an armored battalion, and we don't have radio comms, and we're almost out of bullets, so my XO has every Humvee in the battery, and every truck in the battery, and all that's left is guns and ammo carriers, because we're heavy, and he's got every wheeled vehicle except me going for ammo, and I'm gunning back and forth at about as fast as a Humvee can go, taking fire missions back and forth from the maneuver back to my battery, because we can't talk. And it's not only an example of having to deal with logistical limitations, it's also an example of why drills are limited, because that's not how that works. The battery commander doesn't go and get fire missions from the battalion commander when you read doctrine. It's not how it works.
Right.
But my guns are useless if I don't talk to maneuver, so...
What was your radio problem, Jenny?
What's that?
What was your radio problem, Jenny?
I think they actually had reintroduced EW, so I don't know. It was either terrain or jamming. They would opt for when they're being
kids. Assholes. It's not terrain. Yeah. Unless somebody's on one side of the keyboard and somebody's on the other, it's not terrain.
Yeah.
It was jamming.
Yeah.
Because all your radios couldn't go down.
Well, that's why we talked earlier, sir. Like, I'm a huge proponent of the old skills, is because you never know when something electronic is going
to
fail.
Charts and darts still need to be taught.
They don't. I don't think they do. They started again at Enoch teaching artillery guys charts and darts, but I understand they've stopped.
Multiple chiefs of the artillery in previous years have been talking about how you teach the basic principle of charts and darts, but the APATADS is really the only system you're going to use. The APATADS is the artillery computer. Just so you can, sorry, I'm throwing out acronyms. That the artillery computer that computes the ballistics for you of the mission is what we use. So you don't... The soldiers only need to know, in theory, how to actually do the hand jam. I've got a map and a battle axe and geometry to actually figure out how to shoot. So I actually got talked to because I spent too much time on our old archaic methods of shooting artillery.
The explanation we can still shoot. Yes. The FTCs, it's basically a Hewlett Packard scientific calculator.
They finally updated it to Windows, but yes.
Okay, you. Yes.
It's not an update.
It's an upgrade.
They finally reached
it.
You
throw a smoke round at your best guess, and then you pull it off the smoke.
You know, they used to issue these little ones. Now there's 3 company 11. And it will work sometimes. Sometimes. You can just scan and eventually find the location that moves.
I don't know if you guys have like